On this episode of Classic Gaming Quarterly, let's read Die Hard Game Fan Volume 1, Issue 2 from December of 1992. Before we get into this issue, let's take a quick look back at the origins of Diehard GameFan. Diehard Game Club was a video game store on Ventura Boulevard in Tarzana, California. Owner Dave Halverson advertised Diehard as a mail-order business, selling both domestic and import games in the back of magazines like Electronic Gaming Monthly. These ads were designed by Tim Lindquist, a layout artist whose day job was working at TV Fanfare Publications, doing layouts for free-to-distribute magazines like Sports and Soaps, while making side money designing ads for businesses like Diehard. Halverson began mailing out catalogs for his store, also designed by Lindquist, and it was these catalogs that eventually turned into the magazine. The first issue of Diehard Game Fan was actually printed at Lindquist's day job, and was dropped off free of charge at newsstands in the Los Angeles area who were willing to sell the magazine. For issue 2, GameFan was picked up for national distribution. As it was printed and sold by the same company that distributed Lowrider magazine, GameFan initially found itself being sold in places like liquor stores, but Diehard GameFan was well on its way to taking its place alongside the likes of GamePro and Electronic Gaming Monthly. Alright, so let's go ahead and get into the issue itself. Once again, we're reading Die Hard Game Fan, Volume 1, Issue 2 from December of 1992. And like I already said, the first issue was actually only available in the Los Angeles area, and this was the first issue, therefore, that was available nationally. And as a result, it's kind of hard to find, although much easier to find than the first issue. If you're trying to go for like a complete set for some reason, you're going to have a really hard time tracking down the first issue, and you should be prepared to pay for it. Just for comparative purposes, today I looked up what this issue is going for and was very surprised to see that the last issue of this on eBay sold for about $100, including shipping, which I had no idea was worth anything near that. I paid a lot less for it. Just as a point of interest, this actual issue was Tim Lindquist's personal issue, and I bought it directly from him along with a bunch of other stuff when he put up a post on the Atari Age forums basically selling his whole video game collection and inviting people to come over to his house and have a look. And I went over there and dug through his garage for a while and put together a pile full of stuff, and it was only during the course of doing that that I learned who he was. You know, he saw that I was excited to see a bunch of early issues of Die Hard Game Fan, and he had Hardcore Gamer number one. Hardcore Gamer was another magazine that he launched himself, and so he grabbed this issue and flipped it open to the masthead and pointed to his name and said, "That's me," because I didn't even know his real name. I only knew his forum handle. Anyway, getting back to the issue itself, you can see here that the cover story is Sonic 2. You've got Dr. Robotnik up here, also known as Dr. Eggman, plus Sonic and Tails down here. And you've also got this blue, muscly guy with a TV for a head. And this was like a mascot of the magazine that was on about the first 30 or so issues. For some reason, like halfway through the third year of the magazine, they just sort of quietly got rid of him. Other cover stories include Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and Sunset Riders, the world premiere of Road Rash 2, and the 92-93 football special. So as soon as you open the magazine, the first thing you're greeted with is this big two-page ad for John Madden Football 93 for the Sega Genesis. And this was something that Electronic Arts was really into doing with their EA Sports line, in putting a gigantic ad like this right inside the front cover, which I have to imagine must be prime advertising real estate, because everybody gets at least this far into the magazine, right? And they had a very consistent layout and design of these ads, and if you watched my History of NHL 94 video, you'll see that I showed the ad for NHL Hockey and NHLPA Hockey 92. And 93, excuse me, and they look very similar. This was the style that they went for, and these were really cool ads that I think you'd see these, and it really made you want to buy the game, which was kind of ironic because they're only showing you a couple of little screenshots, but just something about the overall presentation just gave you the impression that EA meant business, and you knew that they were going to bring their A game, no pun intended, to putting out games like this. Next page, we've got the table of contents, and over here we have a letter from the editor along with the masthead. And just to point out, in the letter from the editor, he says, "Welcome to issue 2. This is Dave Halverson, by the way. We are pleased to announce that GameFan has been picked up for national distribution after just one issue, sort of confirming that this is, in fact, the first issue that was available nationally." Over here on the left, there's an ad for Super Batter Up for Super Nintendo. I'm not too worried about that. I did want to talk about this page where you've got the 10 top 10 games and the 10 most wanted games, because I think this really helps to paint a picture of where we are in the gaming timeline. This magazine was probably on the newsstands in November of 92 and was probably written in September and October of 92. Anyway, so top 10, these are games that are already out that gamers are excited about playing at the time. Number one is Soul Blazer for the Super Nintendo, and I was kind of surprised to see that because it's not really a game that you hear talked about that often anymore. Soul Blazer was actually the predecessor to Illusion of Gaia, also on the Super Nintendo, which was sort of a Zelda-style action RPG. Number two, you've got Super Mario Kart, which was released in September of 92. Obviously, a huge blockbuster hit, so not surprised to see that on there. World Heroes for the Neo Geo, which I'm going to talk about later in the issue. Axelay for the Super Nintendo, which is an awesome shooter. Aliens for the Genesis, Street Fighter II for the Super Nintendo, no surprise there. Nintendo, of course, cornered the market and had the only home port of Street Fighter II here in the United States for, I think, about a year, and that really helped to sell a lot of systems. Over here in Most Wanted, we have Sonic 2, which again was the cover story, which came out in late November of 92. I can't remember. I think it was November 24th. I remember it was called Sonic Tuesday, and it was sort of a unified worldwide launch. So if you bought this magazine sort of late in the game, then you probably already could have had Sonic 2. But certainly if you bought this magazine right when it came out, you were probably waiting for Sonic 2. You also have Super Star Wars for the Super Nintendo, Streets of Rage 2 for the Genesis, which, as we know, is one of the greatest beat-em-up games ever made, and came out in December of 92. Moving down the list, you have Cybernator, which is discussed later in this issue. Art of Fighting for the Neo Geo, which is, of course, an awesome fighting game. Batman CD, which I would assume is referring to Batman Returns on the Sega CD, which didn't come out until the spring of 93. And finally, here you've got Sonic CD for the Sega CD, which actually didn't come out until late 1993. So you still had about a year to wait for that game to come out. Here's a section that they call Viewpoint, and basically what this is a distillation of all the reviews that are in this issue, so that if you just want sort of a quick reference, you can look here and see they reviewed Steel Talons on the Genesis, and here's the scores that they gave it, and just sort of a quick précis of what the review is going to be. I guess the two scores, I assume, correspond to Skid and Brody here, which are just two characters that the editors made up. Here in red are all the Super Nintendo games, and then the blue are Genesis games. Orange is Turbo games, and then they reviewed two Neo Geo games. Next page, we have an interview with Wolf Team. Wolf Team came out with a bunch of cool games for the Genesis and Sega CD, including Granada, El Viento, Ernest Evans, Soul Feast, and they were also a major player, I would say, in the early days of the Sega CD. They ported over a lot of Laserdisc-based arcade games, which I don't personally care for, but were somewhat popular back in the day. Over here, you've got Hocus Pocus, which is basically their cheat code section. Very small. Most magazines back then had much beefier cheat code sections, because that was something you could use to really sell the magazine. And you can see here they've got a cheat code for Thunder Force 4 that lets you fully power up your ship. And then here's a cheat code for Mario Kart that I didn't know existed, but doesn't look like it does anything really all that cool. So getting into the Sega sector, so they separated out all the games by what system they're on. And each section has both the reviews and previews. I think reviews first and then previews towards the back. So here you've got two Konami games, Sunset Riders and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles: The Hyperstone Heist. Sunset Riders, if you've never played it, plays kind of like a beat-em-up, except that you have a gun. So it's sort of a beat-em-up slash shoot-em-up. And this was actually a slightly pared-down version of the 1991 Konami arcade game, and was released on the Super Nintendo in, I think, early 93 is when it actually came out. And then over here, as I said, you have the Hyperstone Heist, which is sort of like Turtles in Time for the Genesis, but not quite. They took out some stuff. There's some reused levels, and then there's some new content. It's the only Ninja Turtles game that came out for the Genesis. There was a Tournament Fighters game, I think, but that was a one-on-one fighting game. This was the only sort of beat-em-up style game. The original Ninja Turtles arcade game didn't come out on the Genesis, and neither did Turtles in Time, because they got this instead. Definitely a highly regarded game. Some people consider this one of the best games on the Genesis. I was never a huge Turtles in Time fan, so this is not a game that I've spent that much time with. So here we start a four-page review on Sonic the Hedgehog 2, and certainly it deserves a four-page review, because this is easily one of the best games on the Genesis, although I have just kind of a funny story. I think I like telling stories that make me sound stupid for some reason, but when Sonic the Hedgehog 2 came out, I didn't get it. But my friend did. He actually, his family got a Genesis after Sonic 2 became the pack-in game. But anyway, so the first time I played Sonic the Hedgehog 2 was at his house. And I could not get past the fact that you had Tails following you around everywhere. To me, he was like having this annoying little brother just following you around. And it annoyed me so much it ruined the game. And for a long time, I didn't like Sonic the Hedgehog 2. Because I just felt like, well, why is there this other dude following you around? Like, I know there are certain parts where he can do things, but I felt overall like it was annoying. But the funny part is that what I didn't know is that at the title screen, if you just thumb down on the control pad, you actually expose an options menu. Like, I didn't know you could switch, like, one player, two player. I thought that was it. Keep going. There's an options menu, and you can just disable Tails and play only as Sonic, or you can play only as Tails if you want to. But it wasn't until I found that I actually started playing Sonic 2. So the only cool thing about that is it ended up becoming this marquee title that I didn't really experience until later on, which I think made it kind of cool because it was something I sort of saved for later, except that it was for a really stupid reason. So anyway, getting back to the review, of course they shower the game with praise, as you would expect. And I thought this was a good time to talk about screenshots, because one of the things that GameFan is really known for is the quantity and quality of their screenshots. And I think at this point they're still using composite screen grabs. But one of the things that Tim Lindquist did was convince Dave Halverson to buy an RGB screen capture card. And remember, this is back in the early 90s, so this would have been for like a DOS PC. And for a while, they had the best screenshots out of any video game magazine because theirs were an RGB. As I said, just looking at this, it seems like these are still in composite. Originally, they started out with a composite capture card. But the other thing I was going to say about this is, especially with a game like Sonic the Hedgehog, I really think that it's cooler to go ahead and let the player discover the game for themselves. And if you look at the number of screenshots and the number of levels that they encompass, it's really not leaving much left for you to discover yourself. This is only page 1 and 2, and then you've got page 3 and 4, and this goes all the way up to, this is almost the end of the game. I think the where Tails is flying the airplane is either the second to last level or maybe the last level. I think it's the second to last. And so it'd be kind of disappointing, because to me this is like spoilers. The only thing I think that is cool is that they had stuff like this where they took multiple screenshots and stitched them together, so you got this like zoomed out view. That looks pretty cool. But anyway, like I said, they showered the game with praise, which is well-deserved. And yeah. Next, we have Road Rash 2. This was, in my opinion, the high watermark of the Road Rash series on the 16-bit Genesis. And I have said before on this channel that I'm really not that big of a fan of Road Rash. And I'm going to take this opportunity to sort of explain myself a little bit more. I just think that Road Rash was a little bit too optimistic or adventurous for a 16-bit console. And if you go play Road Rash on a 3DO or on the Sony PlayStation, to me that's what Road Rash should be. You know, it's much smoother gameplay and more responsive controls. And on the Genesis, I just felt like it was sort of a struggle to play the game and enjoy it. But I will say that Road Rash 2 is a huge improvement over the first Road Rash, so if you've never really played the Road Rash series in the Genesis, just get Road Rash 2 and you'll be happy. Again, you see many, many screenshots, and they're definitely very complimentary in their review. As I would expect, Road Rash was a big franchise back then. Next page, we've got WWF WrestleMania and Muhammad Ali Heavyweight Boxing, I believe it's called. It just says Muhammad Ali, but I think the full title was Heavyweight Boxing. Anyway, Super WrestleMania came out on the Super Nintendo first and then was released later on the Genesis, and the Genesis added a lot more content. And that's what they're talking about sort of in this review, is that they've added some content that any Super Nintendo owner would appreciate, because Super Nintendo owners kind of got the shaft a little bit on this game. I was into WWF wrestling, but in like the late 80s. And so by this time, I was no longer interested in buying a wrestling game because there were just too many characters that I didn't care about. You know, they still had Hulk Hogan and Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase, and there's Macho Man, but like the Ultimate Warrior and Shawn Michaels, nothing against them or anything. It was just sort of after what was for me the heyday, you know, when I was like maybe like 10 years old in like 87 or so was when I was in a WWF. Here we've got a review for Steel Talons. And I'm just going to point out what they say at the beginning and the end of the review. At the beginning, he says, "To this point, the Genesis hasn't been able to successfully hold my interest with the polygon simulation style games, as they usually end up choppy or hard to control. I am happy to say that Steel Talons by Tengen doesn't suffer from either." And then at the end, he says, "Overall, Steel Talons is a must for simulation fans, or anyone for that matter. It's just a fun game and a nice departure from the usual shooter or action game." Now, the thing about this is again, I played this game and it's got a frame rate of, I think I'm being generous saying that it's 5 frames per second. So I don't really know how you can say that it isn't choppy. I can see where it's a cool game, but you know, if you were somebody who had access to a PC back then, this was a pretty primitive game, and I certainly don't agree with what they're saying, and I think they're really going overboard, and I could see somebody buying this game based on this review and being horribly disappointed. Over here, you have Captain America and the Avengers, a pretty mediocre, in my opinion, side-scrolling beat-em-up game, like a Final Fight, Streets of Rage-style beat-em-up game. It was a port of an arcade game, and it's kind of got glitchy graphics and just not a good port of the game, and best avoided, certainly. You know, something you could have rented back in the day if you were really itching for Streets of Rage 2 and you couldn't wait for it to come out, but definitely if you bought this game, you were going to be an unhappy camper. So next we have Time Gal. So now we're into the Sega CD. And it says available now in Japan. And they say in the review that, you know, part of the reason that they're showing so many screenshots, and they even say they're going to show more screenshots next month, is that it says it doesn't look like it's going to make it out over here, except that it did make it out over here. Unfortunately, this is another one of those Laserdisc-based arcade games that really plays more like an interactive cartoon and less like a proper video game. So definitely not my kind of game. I'm really not sure why anybody was into these kind of games. You know, it's similar to Dragon's Lair or Space Ace, and just doesn't do it for me at all. Next, we have Cheeky Cheeky Boys. This game is also known as Mega Twins, I believe, in Europe. This was a Capcom CPS arcade game released in 1990. So CPS also had like Final Fight and the first couple iterations of Street Fighter II. It's a pretty cool side-scrolling action platform game, and I actually have this game, and it's kind of funny. I picked this game up at a used video game store several years ago, but you know, certainly after retro gaming was becoming more popular, and it was sitting in a bin. It was complete in the box and looked really nice, and I'd never heard of it. It's kind of an obscure game. I'd never heard of it, but just based on the screenshots in the back of the box, I mean, the graphics are so colorful and detailed, and I just thought, wow, this looks like a pretty cool game. And they literally wanted like $4 for it, because I think they'd never heard of it either and maybe didn't bother to look it up. I have no idea how much the game's actually worth, but if you can get it for $4, then you should jump on that all day long. Definitely a cool action platform game. Over here, we have Road Blaster for the Sega CD. This ended up being released here as Road Avenger, and I think that may be due to the fact that Atari already had a game here called Road Blasters. This, again, is a Laserdisc-based arcade game that is being ported to the Sega CD by Wolf Team. Again, it's that interactive cartoon-style gameplay, and definitely not for me at all. Over here, you've got what they're calling Nobunga and His Ninja Force. And they say this is a compile shooter, and they say compiles Nobunga's Ninja Force is the sequel to the smash hit Mega Drive and Genesis game Musha Aleste. That was known as Musha Aleste in Japan. I think here it was just called Musha. Here, Musha was like an acronym. It was Metallic Uniframe something something armor. I don't remember. It was stupid. In Japan, it was not an acronym. It was just the word Musha. Anyway, it's a celebrated vertically scrolling shooter, and this is the sequel. Now, this ended up getting released in this country as Robo Aleste on the Sega CD. So they changed the name a little bit, but it's the same game, and definitely an awesome game. And it's actually surprisingly cheap, I have to say. Musha is one of the most expensive games on the Genesis, but I think I paid about $20 for a loose Robo Aleste a Sega CD disc, and that was definitely worth it, in my opinion. Here's just sort of a last few quick hits, previews of upcoming Sega games that they, you know, didn't want to dedicate a full page to. Up here you've got Gauntlet. Says the first 16-bit version of Gauntlet is coming to the Mega Drive. That ended up being Gauntlet 4 on the Genesis, which is a great Gauntlet game. And what else do we have here? Here's World of Illusion starring Mickey Mouse. So that was the follow-up to Castle of Illusion. And then down here you see they have a Final Fight is on the Mega CD, almost finished. Will it be two players? Yes, it will be two players. The reason they're asking that, in case you are not aware, is that the port of Final Fight on the Super Nintendo is not two players. So it was certainly a valid question, and gamers would be happy to know that on the Sega CD it is two players. Over here we have Planet SNES, or if you're one of my British viewers, Planet SNES. This is just sort of the same thing, except now we're talking about reviews and previews of Super Nintendo games. First one here, Magical Quest starring Mickey Mouse. I have to say that just based on the age I was around this time, I was 15 when this magazine was on the newsstands. I just really had no interest in playing these Disney games. I played Mickey Mousecapade just a little bit on the Nintendo and didn't really get into it. And that was pretty much the last Disney game I ever played. Like, I never played Castle of Illusion back then, and certainly wasn't playing the Magical Quest. These were always quality games. It was just like, I think it was not really for me, or I thought it wasn't really for me, I should say. You know, to me, it was like, a Mickey Mouse game was for kids, which is pretty ignorant because these are actually pretty good games. So here we've got Cybernator, again, for the Super Nintendo. And this is definitely a lesser-known game, and it's actually too bad. The first part of the review says, "We all know by now when a game says Konami on it, you don't ask. If there's any left, you just buy it." And well, that's kind of a weird thing to say, but it's also kind of true. Konami put out good games, and this one is no exception. This is a game that definitely kind of flew under the radar, and I think a lot of gamers have never actually heard of it or played it. But it's a cool game. Basically, it's a run-and-gun style game, except it's a little bit slower because you take control like this giant like robot suit who looks a lot like Ed 209 from RoboCop, actually. And he also has a jetpack so that he can hover in the air. And the game actually also has horizontally scrolling shooter stages, which is cool. So it's definitely a neat game that you don't hear people talk about. Like I said, you could probably pick it up cheap if you see it somewhere because it's not one of those recognizable titles. I think they actually, they gave it 4 pages, so that kind of tells you what they think of it. This review is glowing, so for whatever that's worth, definitely a cool game. Next, we have Space Megaforce, and something sort of interesting about that. You see up here, they just say it's from Toho, and of course, you can see that it's a vertical shooter. And what's interesting, what seems to completely fly under their radar, is that this is actually another compile shooter, but not any compile shooter. This was released in Japan as Super Aleste. So another installation in the Aleste series. I don't know, you can't really say that it's the sequel to Robo Aleste, I don't think. But if you like those games, this is more of the same. This one throws in a little bit of Mode 7 scaling and rotation. But nowhere in this ad is any mention made of the Aleste series or of Compile. All they have is right down here. It says copyright 1992 Toho Company Limited / Compile. But for a magazine that was sort of trying to be geared towards import gamers, I just thought it was kind of amusing that they totally missed out on that. Over here, we've got an ad for Axelay, and you can see they only actually show a few small screenshots here. They seem to be a lot more concerned with playing up the fact that Electronic Gaming Monthly said that Axelay could be the hottest shooter ever made. Well, Axelay is definitely a really cool game and worth checking out. I'm not sure how good of a job I think this ad does of selling it, but whatever. Here you've got Sonic Blast Man, and this is another side-scrolling beat-em-up, sort of like Streets of Rage or Final Fight. It's got some decently large sprites, not too bad graphics. And the coolest thing I thought about this game is it sort of has this cool helicopter move where you can like grab the enemy players and you spin around and then you can throw them, which I haven't seen in any other beat-em-up, so I kind of thought that was cool. It also used Mode 7 in kind of an interesting way. There's a particular level where you're fighting on a steel girder that's sort of still got ropes tied to it and ostensibly is being hoisted by a crane. And the way the background is oscillating back and forth makes it look like the girder is swinging in the air. And it looks neat, but the only thing is, normally I don't have a problem with getting motion sickness when I play a video game. Like, I can play first-person shooters all day long and not get motion sickness. But there's something about this level in this game that actually makes me sick. Like, I played the game for a while today in preparation for doing this magazine read-through, and playing that level actually made me nauseous and gave me a headache that actually took a while to go away. Here's just some previews for the Super Nintendo. Not really too much to talk about, although down here in the corner it says December 6th, Japanese gamers will line up to take place in the latest installment of Final Fantasy. And that would, of course, be talking about Final Fantasy III, because Final Fantasy, what we call Final Fantasy II here and they call IV, had long ago been released in both regions, and the Japanese were waiting for Final Fantasy, what we call III, and they called VI. You've also got Battletoads here, Ogre Battle, Fist of the North Star, and there's Batman Returns, which, again, is a side-scrolling beat-em-up game, and in my opinion, it's the best side-scrolling beat-em-up game I've ever played for the Super Nintendo. Not saying it's the best one, because I can't say for sure that I've played all of them, but to me, it was like that's kind of their version of Streets of Rage. Definitely a cool game, and I think better than the Super Nintendo version of Final Fight. Here's an ad for Space Megaforce, which we already talked about. And again, here, no mention is made of the fact that it's actually Super Aleste. I really don't know why, but again, definitely a cool game, I think. Kind of a, I don't like to use the term hidden gem, but I'll just say that it's a cool game on the Super Nintendo that most people don't really think about. Here's an ad for the Turbo Duo. They got a full two-page ad. And, you know, this was at the time when the Turbo was not doing well in this country, and they were really trying to push it with a lot of ads. And you can see it comes included with Gate of Thunder, Bonk's Adventure, Bonk's Revenge, and Ease 1 and 2, which was a really great deal. You know, that was four full games. And if you didn't have a TurboGrafx, Bonk's Adventure and Bonk's Revenge are both some of the best games for the TurboGrafx 16. And then, of course, Gate of Thunder is definitely an awesome game, has a sweet soundtrack. It's a horizontally scrolling shooter, if you don't know, and is constantly talked about when people talk about the Turbo CD and the best shooters on the system. And of course, Ease 1 and 2 is action RPG game. And then down here, you've got some upcoming releases that I don't really feel the need to go through. And down here, a free video giveaway you could send away, and they would send you a VHS tape. And I do have a Lords of Thunder VHS tape, but I don't think that's probably not what this was, but who knows. But that was just another tape that was sent to people to try to get them to buy the system or to try to get them to buy games. So again, this is after Street Fighter II has come out for the Super Nintendo. And again, it is not out on any other system. So if you're looking to have that arcade experience with Street Fighter II at home, you had to get a Super Nintendo, and then you were most likely going to want to get a joystick. And so a big thing during this time was to sell joysticks for the Super Nintendo that actually used legitimate arcade parts. And anybody who spent time in the arcades here back in the day will recognize these concave buttons that were probably made by Hap. That's who made most American arcade parts, and that bat-style joystick top. And this one is just in kind of a cheap plastic, what looks like a project box kind of case. And so although it uses good arcade parts, it doesn't look like it would really be that cool. I feel like it would sound like a drum every time you smacked on the buttons. They don't tell you how much it is or anything, but certainly it looks like a cool stick. I don't care for the enclosure that much, but there's going to be another one later in the issue, and they're actually going to have like a little roundup where they're going to review a few joysticks, so we'll check that out. Over here we have Turbo Tunes, and this, again, this is just a section dedicated now to TurboGrafx and Turbo CD games, reviews and previews. The first one they have here is Soldier Blade, which is a vertically scrolling shooter developed by Hudson. They say that it's part 3 in this series, but this is actually part 4 in the series. The first part was Star Soldier, which was released here on the NES, and then there were 3 of these games released on the TurboGrafx. Super Star Soldier, then Final Soldier, then this game. And I know I have Super Star Soldier, but I don't have the 2 follow-up games. Not that it matters, because I have an EverDrive, but sometimes it's still cool to own the original games. Here we've got Forgotten Worlds. Now, I talked about Forgotten Worlds in my Sega Genesis in 1989 video. A cool little tidbit about this game on the Super CD is that you could get a 3-button pad for the PC Engine. And I think there were a few games that it worked for, but I think really the main reason to buy that was to play with this game, because it would be kind of hard to play this game with 2 buttons. I'm not even really sure how that would work. And if you'll recall from that other video that I did, you know, you use the 3 buttons on the Genesis controller. You use A and C to rotate your guy, and then B is to shoot. So over here we have Shadow of the Beast, which was a side-scrolling action game, action platform game. I actually picked up this game about maybe a year or two ago. I was down in Los Angeles, and I went to Game Dude. If any of you have ever been there, it's in North Hollywood. And they actually had a brand new sealed copy of it in the case with the rest of the Turbo games. And it's kind of an interesting place. They just have a price list that they hand you for whatever system. And so none of the games are actually priced, because you just have a price list and you can look on that. And it doesn't matter if the game is brand new and sealed or not. So they wanted like something like $20 for the game, and the copy that they had happened to be brand new and sealed. So I bought it and brought it home, and of course immediately ripped the cellophane off and started playing it. Not really all that impressed with the game from the amount of time that I put into it, but this review is basically positive and kind of makes me feel like I need to spend a little bit more time with the game. Oh, I also wanted to point out, this game was developed by Psygnosis, who was actually one of my favorite developers in the early days of the PlayStation. They developed a lot of early PlayStation games, probably best known for Wipeout. And they ended up becoming Sony Computer Entertainment Studio Liverpool, because Sony ended up buying them out. And they ended up getting closed by Sony in 2012, sadly. But they did a lot of great games for the Amiga and later for the PlayStation. So I just kind of wanted to give them a little mention. Here we have Air Zonk. I think probably all of you are familiar with Air Zonk. Zonk was sort of like a futuristic version of Bonk. This is a horizontal shooter. Some people would call this a cute 'em up. I don't really care for that term. It's just a cartoony, brightly colored shooter game, horizontally scrolling shooter game. Unfortunately, this Hue card has gotten pretty expensive. I don't actually have it, but again, I have an EverDrive, so I just play it on there. I do have the sequel, Super Air Zonk, which was on Super CD, but I have the Japanese version, which is way cheaper. If you try to get the American version of Super Air Zonk, I think it's one of the most expensive TurboGrafx games there is. So don't do that. Here we have Power Drift. This is a game that I think not a lot of people are familiar with. Power Drift was actually developed by Sega and was designed by Yu Suzuki in AM2. This was a 1988, I think, Sega arcade game. It's a kart racing game. And it was released on the PC Engine Hue card and didn't ever come out in this country. And down here we have, again, a few quick hit previews. You see they've got Spriggan, which is a lot of people's favorite shooter on the PC Engine, Zero Wing, and then Afterburner for the PC Engine, which I think I actually have. Now we're into the Neo Geo section, which they call Savage Amusement for some reason. I don't know why they call it that. They only reviewed two Neo Geo games this month. The first is Viewpoint. Now, Viewpoint gets kind of a lot of hate from Neo Geo aficionados, and maybe it's because I'm just not enough of a serious gamer or something. I'm really not sure, because I actually kind of like Viewpoint. It has really good music, I think, and it's sort of an isometric perspective game like Zaxxon, which was an arcade game that was released on the ColecoVision, and I just think it's kind of a cool game. So I don't know how much the cartridge actually costs, because I just played on my multi-cart. So I probably wouldn't pay too much money for it, but I think it's a cool game. It's got some varied levels in it, and I appreciate what they were trying to do with it. Over here we have Soccer Brawl. This is a lesser-known Neo Geo game for sure. If you've ever played 2020 Super Baseball, that's what this game is, but with soccer instead. You know, it's sort of like not robot. I don't know what you call something that's half human and half android or whatever. Basically, those people playing soccer, sort of like extreme futuristic soccer. And it's definitely, I think, a neat game. If you want to play soccer, but you want to play something a little bit different, that's a cool game to check out. So here we got World Heroes. So World Heroes kind of holds a special place in my heart. When I got my consolized MVS, this was one of the first games that I bought. And the reason for that is this is actually the first Neo Geo game that I ever played. There was a 7-Eleven around the corner from my high school. And so often my friend Nick and I would go to that 7-Eleven on the way to his house, you know, and buy a Slurpee and pump a few quarters into their Neo Geo 2 slot, which had World Heroes. I can't remember what the other game was in the 2 slot. Later, I remember they got Samurai Showdown as the second game, but that didn't come until later. But anyway, for that reason, I really love World Heroes. It's a clear Street Fighter II The World Warrior ripoff, but it's got its own cool flavor, I think. And you can play as Rasputin, which I think is really cool. His hands get all super huge. And, you know, I had learned about Rasputin and Tsar Nicholas and whatnot in school. And so for some reason, I thought it was cool that he was in a video game. Here, I don't know what this is. It's this section called The Graveyard. I don't know if they were planning on reviewing like a spooky game every month or something. This month it was Decap Attack for the Sega Genesis. Kind of a neat action platform game. You play as a decapitated mummy. I've never actually played this game, so I can only say, I guess, that it looks neat. I've seen video footage of it, and then of course they've got 10,000 screenshots here. And it's a game that I've seen a lot. You know, I've seen it at game stores and whatnot, and for some reason I just never bought it. Obviously, I could just check it out now on an EverDrive, but they certainly think that it's a good game. They give it an excellent review. So if you're looking for something different to play, might be a game you want to check out. There's an ad for Captain America and the Avengers, which we already talked about. Just a quick little one-page synopsis about what's going on in the handheld gaming world. Nothing about Game Boy at all, but they do talk about the Lynx and the Game Gear. But really, they're just showing a few screenshots of upcoming Lynx games and upcoming Game Gear games. It's kind of funny. I really wanted a Game Gear when I was a teenager. And I worked and I saved up enough money to go down to the electronics store and buy a Game Gear. And I went in there to get one, and they were actually sold out of Game Gears, which is weird because this wasn't like right when the system came out. But they didn't have one, so I didn't get to get one. And for some reason, I just never bought one. Like, I must have taken that money and spent it on, I don't know, I honestly don't know what I spent it on, but it wasn't on a Game Gear, that's for sure. And I'm kind of glad I didn't. I actually don't really care for the Game Gear. I think the screen is really kind of crappy, and I'm sure I wouldn't have thought that back then, but I have had a Game Gear at various points, and I always end up just getting rid of it. I did have a Lynx, but I didn't actually get my Lynx until 1995. I bought it off of a coworker, and that I still do have, and I actually kind of like the Lynx, although my feeling about the screen on the Game Gear kind of holds true with the Lynx as well. It's not the best screen. But I think it was cool, and it's a shame that the Lynx wasn't more successful. You know, the Atari Corporation really died a sad death, unfortunately. So here is another ad for one of these fighting joysticks for the Super Nintendo. And this one looks like a lot higher quality. You can see that it's made out of MDF, it's laminated and has the T molding, and even has sort of that granite finish that Street Fighter II Champion Edition had, the arcade cab had. The only thing that looks weird about it is I don't understand why, I don't know if you can see well, but the joystick is right here. It's like right in the middle of the enclosure, and it's like right next to the button. So you'd be playing it, you know, like this instead of like this. And I don't know why they would really choose to do that. Certainly not a deal breaker at all, but it just seems like it'd be so much more comfortable if you slid the joystick over here a little bit. Not sure why they didn't do that. $99.99 seems to me to be a reasonable price. I don't know what that translates in 2016 dollars, but seems like a cool joystick to me anyway. Here we start with their football special, which I won't harp on for too long because I know a lot of you aren't sports gamers. Here we've got Mr. TV Head Blue Guy again, which is kind of cool. First game they talk about is Capcom's MVP Football, which I have never played. That was a Super Nintendo game, but I've never actually played it. I really just stick to playing the Madden games in 16-bit consoles. Now, over here, this is actually kind of interesting. Here's John Madden Football 93 for the Super Nintendo, and then here's Madden 93 for the Genesis. And the reason that the Super Nintendo version is getting sort of a page to itself is that this was actually kind of a bigger deal. And I only say that because the original John Madden Football for the Super Nintendo was really bad, especially compared to the Genesis versions. Like, if you played Madden on the Genesis and then went and bought the Super Nintendo version when it came out finally, you were going to be real disappointed. Like, it really wasn't the same game and just didn't play well at all. But for 93, they made this game play a lot more like the Genesis game, which is what it should have been in the first place. So you see over here, they only give a half page to the Genesis version because basically it's just still good. You know, Madden 92 on the Genesis was good, and this is just, you know, this one's just better. This one was more like, okay, thank God, now we're going to have a good Madden game on the Super Nintendo. Down here, you've got Sports Talk Football starring Joe Montana. And this is it's called Sports Talk. Sports Talk was a sort of a short series of games that the Genesis had. I think I've said previously in another video that I thought that Sports Talk Baseball was the best baseball game on the Genesis. And the reason it's called Sports Talk is because it actually has a real-time play-by-play commentary, vocal commentary.
Across the 10, 20, he drops it, scramble for the ball. San Francisco has it, end zone, the score is 6-0.
It doesn't really keep up with the game as well as it could, but just the fact that it had that at all on the Genesis was pretty awesome. And this game actually, this one is horizontally scrolling, has a horizontally scrolling field instead of vertical, which makes this game play a lot more like the PC version, which is the version of Joe Montana Football that I played back then. Finally, here we've got NFL Football for the Super Nintendo, which looks really Mode 7 heavy, and I'm pretty sure I wouldn't like it. And then here you've got Pro Quarterback also for the Super Nintendo. Again, I can't say that I've played it. Gotta say it looks pretty decent, though. And if you look down here, they sort of declare their winners. Of course, on the Genesis, is going to be John Madden 93, one of the best football games I think ever made. And on the Super Nintendo, it's actually a tie. They're saying you could get Madden 93, or you could go with this Pro Quarterback game. Kind of makes me think that I would like to check it out. Here's the Fighting Stick review article that I was mentioning earlier, where they take four of these fighting sticks and review them. These are the two that we already saw the ads for, and they add this Sonic stick, which actually looks like a cool compromise between the two. It's got more of the button placement of this stick, but it's also made out of MDF and has T-molding like this stick. And it's also $89, which is $10 cheaper than this stick. The plastic enclosure joystick, again, still doesn't have a price. And then they also talk about the Capcom Fighter Power Stick, which kind of has parts in it that are more what you'd have expect out of like a Super Advantage joystick or Sega arcade stick. So doesn't really give you that realistic arcade experience. Here in Other Stuff, I don't know why it's just called Other Stuff. This is actually an article talking about the launch of the Sega CD. Now, the Sega CD was launched in this country in the middle of October. So this must have been something that they wrote like last minute before they went to press. And they're just talking about like how well the launch of the system went, and then talking about some of the early games for the system, like Sewer Shark, Hook, which is a pretty decent platform game, Chuck Rock, which I said I don't really care for that much, and then Black Hole Assault. And then you've got some screenshots here for other games like Jaguar XJ220. And then this article is continued on the next page where they talk about a bunch of the games that are going to be coming out. Terminator is an awesome run-and-gun game for the Sega CD. Wolf Child is pretty sweet. Secret of Monkey Island, which of course is a port of a PC game. Night Trap, which got Sega into a lot of trouble with Congress. And Joe Montana's NFL Football. Then as we move through here, I don't really consider this stuff to be quite as interesting. They're talking about they took a trip to Japan and they're just showing off some pictures. Would have been really cool back then, but not really as interesting now. Here's a picture inside a Japanese arcade. You probably can't see it, but it's just tons and tons of Aero City cabinets, which were the predecessor to Astro City cabinets, which is what I have. I think we're almost to the last page here. Again, just more. Here's some stuff going on in the arcades. They've got, what is this, Virtua Racing. They say Virtual Racing, but it was Virtua Racing from Sega. And here's Lethal Enforcers. Here they have, for some reason, a little article about an actress that played Chun-Li in some Street Fighter II commercials. Not sure why that really matters. And then this last section sort of reads like Quarterman in EGM, if you're familiar with that. You know, it's just a little bit of quick scuttlebutt. They talk about the Neo Geo CD system coming out, and they're talking about how Nintendo and Sony have both announced an agreement to manufacture and market their own CD systems, and the Sony system will combine the Super Nintendo with a CD-ROM drive. So, you know, that's that prototype system that was sort of recently discovered, and I think somebody powered it on YouTube or something. That's what that's making reference to. And then the rest of the article is just talking about how CDs are probably the wave of the future in gaming, which of course they were. Lastly, here you've got a release schedule, just sort of talking about the games that are going to be coming out soon and what month they're coming out. Of course, they're organized by what system they're coming out on. They tell you, you know, what kind of game it is and who the publisher is. But stuff like this was nice because although it seems like a no-brainer, a lot of the early video game magazines just didn't do this for some reason. So if you were trying to sort of plan out your video game purchases for the foreseeable future, you could use something like that. And then here's the little subscription form if you want to send in for a subscription. 12 issues of Game Fan is only $24.99. Pretty good deal, actually. It's only, $2 an issue. So not bad. I think the cover price of this was $4. So over here, just an ad for Muhammad Ali, which, as I said, not a game that I'm really into, but apparently not a bad game. And then finally, on the back cover, you have a Tengen, I still don't know how to say it, ad, RBI Baseball 4, Steel Talons, Rampart, and Paperboy 2, all for the Genesis. Always a big fan of Tengen, so cool to see that. So again, there we have it, Die Hard Game Fan, Volume 1, Issue 2, from December of 1992. That's going to do it for this episode of Classic Gaming Quarterly. If you're actually still watching this after almost an hour, you get mad respect from me. And if you're not subscribed yet, sounds like it's time to do so. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.